acute kidney injury or acute renal failure. Basically, acute kidney injury or acute renal failure, it is traditionally defined as the sudden decrease in the renal functions result in retention of nitrogenous waste products as well as loss of the regulation of the extracellular volume and electrolyte. So in the initial days, still now, there are two terms used. One is acute renal failure, other is acute kidney injury. Basically, ARF, all the patients of renal failure, all the patients which are included in the ARF are not presented with, but there are some patients which are already early present, so that is called acute kidney injury, because insult occur early and detection is very important. Early intervention, early detection, early treatment is important. So not all the NART patients are in failure. Acute renal failure, reduction in GFR is often because ARF or AKI usually reversible. CKD is chronic kidney disease or chronic renal failure is not reversible. This is the difference between two. How much creatinine increase? Acute renal failure, 0.5 milligram per deciliter within 48 hours, or 50% increase to at least 2 milligram per deciliter, and urine output should be decreased, and what urea level should be increased, normally 20 to 40 milligram per deciliter, but depend upon the presentation the urea is how much is increased. So lot of the definitions are available that show the complexity of the problem. As far as concerned of the classification of AKI, it is classified into Rifle's criteria and AKI and staging. Rifle, R for risk, injury, failure, loss, and end stage. But after the passage of time, they change, they revise the criteria. Acute kidney injury network classification. Because all the patients not develop the end stage renal disease, so they change the Rifle's criteria to acute kidney injury network staging. So this is the Rifle criteria. The International Acute Dialysis Quality Initiative Group, DOQI guidelines, they said the Rifle's criteria for acute renal failure, it depends upon the two components. One is the GFR criteria, two criteria. One is GFR criteria, other is urine output criteria. So already said Rifle, risk, injury, failure, loss, and end-stage renal disease. What about risk? Increased serum creatinine more than 1.5 or GFR decrease more than 25% from normal. And regarding the urine output, it should be less than 0.5 ml per kg per hour, a duration of 6 hours. Then injury, increased serum creatinine, means doubling of serum creatinine, and GFR decrease 50% decrease. And urine output also declined same, but duration is 12 hours. Then failure, increased serum creatinine, triple time, GFR decrease more than 75%, and urine output decline from 0.5 to 0.3 ml per kg per hour, and sometime patient become aneuric. After that, you see the last and end stage renal disease. Last means persistent acute renal failure of kidney function, complete loss of the renal function more than 4 weeks. Then end stage renal disease, the duration is more than 3 months. These last two components are deleted from this Rifle's criteria, and that is called acute kidney injury network classification. Same already told you, 1, 2, 3, because 5 components which are present in the in the Rifle's criteria, and 3 components which are present in the acute kidney injury network classification. Okay. Nowadays there are the biomarkers which are used for the early detection of the acute kidney injury. Because these are the new biomarkers, urinary biomarkers, which are checked in the urine for the early detection of acute kidney diseases. The biomarkers, one is KIM-1 Engel. KIM-1 is detected by ELISA method, and the importance of KIM-1 that suggests ischemic ATN and nephrotoxin drugs. This Engel Western blot method, ischemic ATN and nephrotoxic, NH3 immunoblast, ischemic ATN, perirenal azotemia and postrenal, interleukin, cytokine, delayed graft function after the kidney transplant, and after the cystatin C, proximal tibular injury, that suggests that where is the injury, because biomarkers, importance of biomarkers, early detection and the site of the injury. Why biomarkers are present? Because this biomarker should be done to identify the primary location of injury to the proximal tibule or distal tibule, interstitium or vasculature. So it tells us the site of injury and differentiation of the AKI subtypes, prerenal, renal or postrenal. Identify the AKI etiology, predict the outcome of the acute kidney injury, and it helps in the monitoring the response of the therapy. The conventional urinary biomarkers like CAST, VexiCAST and broad VexiCAST, these are RBC-CAST, WBC-CAST, RBC-CAST present the glomerular disease, WBC-CAST acute pyelonephritis, FeNA. FeNA is the fractional excretion of the sodium. That will tell us either prerenal or renal. If it is less than 1 FeNA value of, then it is called prerenal. If it is more than 1, that is renal. Urinary proteins, high molecular weight, tubular proteins or enzyme. So these are the conventional urinary biomarkers. These are the non-specific intensive for early recognition of the AKI. So this is a pictorial presentation. This chart taken from the comprehensive book of nephrology that shows the etiology of the acute renal failure. If you see the acute renal failure, in first prerenal azotemia, there are variety of the causes. Prerenal azotemia is due to either hypovolemia, cardiac failure or hepatorenal syndrome. Then renal artery or renal artery occlusion, large or medium vessel vasculitis, small vessel vasculitis, various diseases like thrombotic microangiopathy, hemolytic uremic syndrome, or DTP, renal atheroembolism, small vessel vasculitis. Glomerular disease like anti-GBM disease, SLE, post-infectious GN, infected endocarditis, MPGN, IgA nephropathy, ATN, either due to ischemia, nephrotoxicity, or rhabdomyolysis. So there are a lot of the causes of acute renal failure. If you see in the hospital setting, the causes of acute renal failure, majority of the patient are in the acute tubular necrosis, this yellow bar shows the acute tubular necrosis, after that pre-renal, and then acute onset of chronic renal failure, after that obstruction and acute interstitial nephritis. So coming to the ATN, basically ATN is acute tubular necrosis. Basically it is the histological diagnosis. Commonly occur in the high risk setting like post-vascular, post-cardiac surgery, severe burns, pancreatitis, sepsis, or CLD. It is responsible for most cases of the hospital acquired ARA and usually considered to be due to ischemic or nephrotic injury. This diagram shows the nephrotoxic agents that leads to acute renal failure. So there are the various drugs that leads to acute renal failure. You can read from the pre-renal and small vessel vasculitis. And now common problem in our practice, because this radio contrast is used sometime in case of angiography or in case of MRI with contrast, CT with contrast, or IVP. So there are the different type of contrast which are used. Sometimes this contrast leads to nephropathy, renal failure. So ARF secondary to contrast nephropathy typically occurs in a patient with underlying renal impairment, are rarely seen in patient with a normal renal function. It may occur intravenous or intra-arterial, but not oral. Oral contrast is not dangerous. The incidence of contrast nephrotoxicity is about 20%, and 50% patient with the serum creatinine LAD more than 2 mg or 5 mg respectively. Regarding the definition of the contrast nephropathy, it is the new onset of exacerbation of renal dysfunction after contrast administration in the absence of other causes, increased by 25% or absolute increase serum creatinine 0.5 mg per deciliter from baseline. The pattern of this contrast, if you use the contrast after angiography or contrast MRI or CT, after 24 hours or 48 hours post exposure of the contrast, creatinine raise and peak 5 to 7 days later, normalization within 7 to 10 days, most of the cases recover in the 10 days, and mostly these patients are the non-oligouric. This slide shows the risk factor for contrast-induced nephropathy. There are two types. One is patient-related risk factor, other is procedure-related risk factor. Patients-related risk factor, like those patients whose renal functions are disturbed, that is the renal insufficiency, diabetic patient, elderly population, dehydrated patient, hypotension, cardiac failure, congestive heart failure, or nephrotoxic or renal transplant. Procedure related multiple, if you use the multiple contrast media injection within 72 hours or intra-arterial or use the high volume of the contrast or high osmolality of the contrast media. So these patients are more prone to develop radiocontrast induced nephropathy. Now what are the strategies to decrease the AKI? One is proven efficacy, other is the possible effective measures. Proven efficacy, avoidance of the nephrotoxins, single daily dose or aminoglycoside, drug modification, lysosomal, like the drugs which are used, amphotericin or DI. We should hydrate the patient in case of radio contrast use, or if you use the cisplatin or rhabdomyolysis, tumor lysis syndrome, or possible effective procedure, we should monitor the drug level, adequate renal perfusion, low dose of the calcium channel drug, N-acetylcysteine. So in conclusion, acute kidney injury gives the better perception. Use the term failure is question mark. So it is an irreversible situation when a sizable number of the patient recover to completely normal renal function. New biomarkers can predict early injury and outcome. Hence the term acute kidney injury is rational. Current classification of AKI takes into account already minimal change in serum creatinine. These minimal changes have an impact on outcome. So determination is still biased on serum creatinine remain a problem. So this was all for regarding the acute renal failure or acute kidney injury. Now the second portion of this lecture is the CKD. Or CRF, chronic kidney disease, or chronic renal failure. CKD is a worldwide public health problem. There is rising incidence and prevalence of kidney failure, poor outcome, and high cost. And there is even higher prevalence of earlier stages of CKD. And adverse outcome of CKD can often be prevented or delayed. So regarding the definition of the CKD, that was the introduction. Kidney damage or decreased kidney function or decreased GFR for more than 3 months. How will you detect the kidney damage? By proteinuria, abnormal urine segment, abnormal serum or urine chemistries, and abnormal imaging. So one is proteinuria, spot urinary tests are preferred to 24-hour urinary test because 24-hour urine collection is difficult. So these are the stages of the proteinuria. Normally, normal albuminuria should be less than 30 milligram per day. If it is between 30 to 300, that is called microalbuminuria, and protein creatinine ratio 0.03 to 0.3. Non-nephrotic range less than 3.5 gram per day, or PCR protein creatinine ratio less than 3. Then nephrotic range more than 3.5 gram per day, or PCR is more than 3. So by renal clearance, the function is should be checked by renal clearance. Ideal agent is inulin, which is not on nowadays used because it can cause the kidney injury. So practically we are doing the serum creatinine, and we should do the creatinine clear estimation, but problem is that it will not tell us the exact figure. sometimes 10% higher due to tubular secretion of creatinine. So GFR, glomerular filtration rate, it varies with the age. After age of 40, decline 1 ml per minute per year. Sex, male and female, there is a difference. In male, GFR slightly higher as compared to female. Body size, more muscle mass, more serum creatinine. So normal GFR is 120 to 130 ml per minute per meter square. GFR estimation, you can do even the, there is the formula, Cock-Kraft-Galt equation, that is mostly widely used. You can do even the, at the clinic or in the outdoor patient OPD or at home. This is the 140 minus age multiplied by the weight in kg divided by 72 multiplied by serum creatinine. If the patient is female, we should multiply it by with 0.85 because due to surface area. So classification of CKD, stage 0 or at risk. Stage 1, kidney damage with normal GFR. Stage 2, GFR present between 60 to 89. Stage 3, GFR 30 to 59. Stage 4, 15 to 29. If it is less than 15, that is stage 5. These patients require RRT, that is renal replacement therapy. Then coming to the etiology of the CKD, there are various glomerular diseases. Diabetes is the leading cause of the CKD in the whole world as well as in Pakistan. Hypertension, second, chronic pyelonephritis, recurrent UTI, polycystic kidney disease, or tubular interstitial nephritis, obstructive uropathy, sometime unknown cause. These patients can present, the variety are present, usually asymptomatic, the severe renal function disturbed, fatigue, dyspnea, anorexia, hypertension, edema. Sometimes they complain pruritus or itching, muscle cramps, flapping tremors, restless legs, nocturia or polyuria, fits, bony pains. On examination, skin pigmentation or excretion. Patient should be pale, anemic. If you check the blood pressure, hypertension, maybe postural hypertension, edema is present, half and half nails or brown nails, left ventricular hypertrophy, sometime fluid overload, so respiratory crackles. Arterial burui may be present in case of vasculitis or Takayasu disease, or palpable kidney, polycystic kidney, hydronephrosis. Abdominal scar may be present in the transplanted kidney or previous surgery of the kidney. Peripheral vascular disease, neuropathy, proximal myopathy, if you do the fundoscopy, diabetic retinopathy and hypertension nephropathy. This figure shows the brown nails or teres and half nails which are present in case of CKD. As far as concerned, the investigation, laboratory investigation, workup of the CKD, CBC, that shows the patient should be anemic, renal function should be disturbed, urea, creatinine, electrolyte, urine analysis. Already in previous lecture I have teach you proteinuria, hematuria or cast cells, blood chemistry, lipid and iron profile, serum iron, TIBC, serum ferritin. Then we should do the serology, because these patients sometimes require hemodialysis. Hepatitis B, anti-HCV, hepatitis B antibodies. ABGs should check the metabolic acidosis, GFR, two method, estimated or mere. Ultrasound has got important to see the size of the kidney, echogenicity of the kidney, either stones, hydronephrosis, or corticomedullary dysfunction intact, and we should check the prostate in elderly patients. It can cause obstructive uropathy or mass. X-ray chest should be done. Echocardiography has got important because long-term hypertension can cause left ventricular hypertrophy, or ejection fraction should be checked. Bone X-ray to see the radiological changes of the renal osteodystrophy. Prevention of the progression, treat the modifier risk factor, lifestyle modification by doing exercise. Cessation of smoking, BP should be less than 130/80. Diabetic should be controlled, HbA1c should be less than 6.4. And for control of blood pressure and for microalbuminuria, we should give the ACE inhibitor or ARBs, or if the patient is hypertensive, ACE and ARBs is a drug of choice. Protein restriction, normally 1 gram per kilogram per day, but in these patients 0.6 to 0.8 gram per kilogram per day. Low salt diet, it should be less than 2 gram per day. Avoid nephrotoxic agents like contrast non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs and aminoglycosides. So treatment measures like correction of anemia by iron supplement, erythropoietin supplement agent, correction of bone disease like hyperphosphatemia and hypocalcemia or hyperparathyroidism. Hypertension and CKD should be controlled by various drugs, ACE inhibitor, thyroid diuretics, calcium channel blockers, beta blockers, or loop diuretic. The aim of blood pressure should be 130/80 non-diabetic or no proteinuria. If the patient is diabetic and proteinuria, it should be 120/70, and hyperlipidemia should be controlled. National Kidney Foundation DOKI guidelines say target should be LDL should be less than 100. We should vaccinate these patients because this patient may require hemodialysis. Ideally, vascular access should be formed in these patients when they present with stage 4 or near to stage 5. So we should create heavy fistula, arteriovenous fistula, at least 3 months before the initiating of the dialysis, or AV graft, arteriovenous graft, before 1 month, or temporary or tunnel catheter at the time of the dialysis. So renal replacement therapy comprises of hemodialysis, renal transplant, and continuous ambulatory peritoneal dialysis. So it should be done when the GFR is less than 15 ml per minute or stage 5. Now question is that when to start dialysis in these patients, CKD patients. KDOKI guidelines and European guidelines suggest when GFR is less than 15 ml per minute and clinical indications are important. Always we should treat the patient clinically, but we should not treat the numbers. Clinical presentation is very important because these patients present a variety of the symptoms: nausea, vomiting, weight loss, pulmonary edema, hyperkalemia, or pericarditis, uremic pericarditis. Then dialysis should be initiated in these patients. So thank you very much.